Lake City, Brian Wright. You're here watching my show, Honky Tonkitis, inside Nashville. We're here to talk about real country music and play you some. And tonight we're also going to chat with our bandmate, Mr. Danny Rader, about his career in country music. Well, I don't know where everybody's at right now, but we're going to start off with a song about where I'm from. It's called Down in Dixie. Y'all kick it off. Up in the Georgia pines in the Red Bay off of 29. I learned to hunt, fish, and drive before I was waist high. Need no drug to get high. Tennessee whiskey worked just fine. Skied the hooch on the Georgia line, obeyed the law most of the time. I was born a son of a southern man, come from a long line of hard-working hands. We're just good folk, doing the best that we can. Yeah, down in Dixie. Church, cut my teeth on a hymnal book, read the gospel front to back, don't try to stray too far from that. But I've been caught a hill river, locked up twice on bad behavior. It's hard to keep it between the ditches when you're showing out of them Georgia peaches. I was born a son of a southern man, I come from a long line. That's how we get down. Now, where's everybody at tonight? Who we got down there? I see some people from out west. I think we had some Australians on here last time. Anybody? Oh, there's some Noonan crowd. We got some people down in Dixie. There they are. Charlene, I see you. Enjoy. Look at Gerald Reed. That's a local boy. Swanee Sue, where you at up there in Wisconsin? All right. Glad y'all are checking in. We're here to play some real country music like we talked about, and we're going to play another one. We hadn't done this one in a while. It's on the next album that's getting ready to come out here in another week or so, I guess. Anyway, this song's called No Love in a Honky Tonk. Goes like this here. Drunk.
by the crying of a steel guitar and a neon sign. Yes, some of us learn, but most of us don't. There ain't no love in a honky-tonk. Socially, it's where the lonely go. The old feel young, and the young feel old. It's a highway to hell, this ain't no street of gold. Now there ain't no love in a honky-tonk. Everyone is smiling, having fun, crying like hell to drink that heartache undone. It'll pick you up, but love you it won't. Oh, there ain't no love in a honky-tonk.
On the next album, thank you. That's album is called "They're All Drinking Songs," and I think you've heard a couple of them off of the off of that one. That's one of them right there. I kind of like that song a lot, but yeah, I wrote that when I got to thinking. You know, you go in these honky tonks, and it's usually either people that ain't got nothing to lose or people that are looking for something, and there's not a lot of people right in the middle unless they're the ones that are serving the drinks or collecting the money. So, anyway.
Wise words.
Yeah, I think so. Anyway, that'll be coming out next week. We'll have the album out. It's going to be a little bit of a different release. We're releasing one song at a time, and then we're going to have the album at the end. So you don't know what's on it until that we're done releasing all the singles. So there'll be opportunity for that, and you'll be hearing about it if you're on my email list or on my Big City Brian Wright Facebook page. Which, if you're listening right now, you'd already know about that. But that'll be next week, so y'all tune into that. All right. We're going to talk to our buddy over here, Danny Rader.
Hey!
Yeah.
Danny's not only a good friend of mine, and he's my neighbor, but he's a multi-instrumentalist and ACM nominee, multi-nominee, award-winning specialty instrument of the year, session player, road dog, producer, singer, songwriter, beer drinker, and Nashville Predators hockey fan, and man, he's just hitting all the marks. So we'll talk to Danny about his career in country music tonight. Now, I'm sitting here saying all that, and I'm not even joking, because you got your hands in everything, and it's a lot of guys here are very talented, and they're all in several different areas too. But I don't play with a whole lot of guys that can just pick up any instrument or do any of these things and do them really well. So why don't you tell us what planet you're from first?
Well, I'm from a strange, strange place called Panama City, Florida.
Oh, that's the reason right there. You got all mixed up down there in Redneck Riviera.
There are actually people from there, believe it or not.
Well, a little bit of information about that, just from my perspective, is Panama City was like going to Europe when I was growing up,
right,
down in Noonan, Georgia. You know, that was where you went for vacation, and it seemed like a long way away because you had to ride in the car and you had to go down the interstate.
Right.
So we got to go there when I was a kid, and I always appreciated it. But growing up there, I can't even imagine. But I do remember a little bit of information, but I'm going to let you carry on, and I'll talk about that.
Yeah, so my family owned and operated. And so backstory, in 1978, my granddad and his kids, they didn't have any grandkids yet, so my parents' generation and my granddad, they all moved to Panama City, Florida, and bought 10 acres of land and built a 1,000-seat theater and put a country music show in there, very much like a Branson Pigeon Forge kind of vibe. And so we did over 200 shows a year with our family throughout my entire childhood.
It's an incredible leap of faith for an entrepreneur, you know, to do something like that.
Oh, man, I can't even imagine. You know, so my granddad, he was 40 or 41 when he moved down there. Complete change of job, complete change of scene, change of everything. And I don't even know if I would have the courage or the will to do that at this point in life, but he did it.
Man,
he just always wanted to have a country music show, and he loved country music, and Ernest Tubbs is his favorite singer, and he just wanted to start a show and sing music with his family.
That is awesome.
And he did it.
Well, what I was going to say is, as a kid, going down to Panama City and going on vacations, I remember passing the Ocean Opry sign, you know, the spray-painted airbrush, whatever it was, the big Ocean Opry signs at all the big intersections on the way down there. What a cool thing, and what a neat thing to be involved with, especially with your family and doing all that
stuff. It was so fun, and, you know, to do that many shows with your family, and it was a very interesting experience because there was, you know, work was family and family was work, so there was a little bit of a blurring of those lines at times, but I didn't know anything different, so we just... It was normal, and we loved it, and, you know, we as kids got to grow up, and, you know, in addition to doing our family shows, my granddad promoted shows, so throughout the 30-plus years that they ran the show, we had a ton of Grand Ole Opry artists, everyone from Merle Haggard to Glenn Campbell, you know, Oak Ridge Boys, Mel Tillis, Ray Price, I mean, the list of artists that didn't come through is far shorter than those that did. Johnny Cash.
But think about the incredible experiences that taking that risk and doing that, not only did it open up doors for you personally, but just for your entire family. I mean, what a great history and what a great memory. And I mean, that's a pretty neat opportunity. So
yeah, it was.
I think about stuff like that all the time. You know, people think you're crazy when you're doing. I mean, I'm an airline pilot, and I'm sitting here doing this crazy thing on Facebook, you know, and playing live shows and making records. It's like, but the opportunities and the people that I've gotten to meet are just, it blows my mind.
Yeah.
I'm so thankful for it, and I'm sure
you
have that same
experience. You do it because you love it.
That's right. Well, obviously you were down there, and you were mixing it up with your family, and and you're, I think you told me you and your brother were playing all the instruments and recording stuff at once. And
yeah, my first kind of dabbling and experience in studio work was we had a studio at the Opry, and I can remember when we kind of upgraded a little bit. You know, when I was little, I used to watch my dad do it when I was a kid. But at a certain point, my older brother, Brent, who has done a bunch of gigs with me, he lives here in town, and a fantastic player.
And played on my last record.
That's right. That's right, he did.
Thank you, Brent.
And so he and I eventually kind of took over the studio in our building, and I would go up there. There's times I would skip school and go up there just to learn how to work the equipment and how to try to get drum sounds and, you know, work the stuff. And so he and I started doing a lot of session work around at some various other studios around town, so... We would do a lot of work where sometimes there were a few other musicians that would be involved, but a lot of it was just he and I, and we'd play to a click track, and I'd play drums, and he'd play bass, or vice versa. Yeah. And then I'd stack guitars, and he'd stack all the keyboards, and we'd have a 10-song record finished by the end of the day.
Man, that's crazy. But that's a great experience, too, and trial and error, and that's, you know, you're in an opportunity where you really can't make anybody mad, so you get really good at it before.
Yeah, I mean, there wasn't really any other option if we had an off day or kind of screwed up. It's not like they could hire somebody else and not call us next time.
<That's right.
laughs> So it's a great place to learn.
Yeah, that's right. And you're learning outside of the professional environment here where you really can't make any mistakes
or
you can't ever do it again.
Exactly, yeah.
Well, at what point did you get up the nerve or decide, all right, I'm doing this for a living, I want to move to Nashville?
So my wife and I got married in 2003, and about the time we got married, she was wanting to finish her school, and I had finished 2 years of school at community college back home. And she, you know, we were kind of looking at Belmont for her because she was kind of eyeing that, and I always knew that Nashville was going to be where I wanted to end up. There was no question for me about, you know, L.A. or New York or any of the other kind of music metropolitan areas. I was like, Nashville. Every record I bought as a kid was – made in Nashville, and that was just that's where I wanted to come and make music, you know.
That's
so
awesome.
So it was just more a matter of when, you know, and it just kind of the time became right when I felt like I just was kind of wanted to see what was out there, and I just was like, I want to go for it.
And there wasn't any blue lights or anything in your rearview mirror.
Thankfully. I mean, there have been blue lights in my rearview mirror at times, but
hopefully
not on that drive. No, actually, a funny story. When we moved up here, our U-Haul broke down. Not a ton of people know this story. Our U-Haul broke down just south of Birmingham, and
we spent about
3.5 hours on the side of the interstate waiting for a tow truck to come.
Yeah.
And once they finally did, they pulled us up to Birmingham, and something had gone down at that point. So we ended up having to stay the night there. They tried to fix the truck the next day, and they didn't get it fixed till probably 4 or 5 o'clock. So it took us about 36 hours to drive what would normally take about a 7-hour drive from Florida to Nashville.
All right. So when you got to Nashville, and or when you had your sights set on Nashville, what instrument were you saying, all right, this is what I'm going to do, or what job were you shooting for right out of the gate?
At that point, I was kind of playing as much guitar and bass.
Yeah.
And so that's kind of was like, I'm just going to say yes to anything that comes up and see where I land, you know.
Yeah.
And initially, I actually started as a drummer when I was super young. So that was my main thing until I was 17 or 18. And I really dug into guitar work at that point, mostly because at all the studios, there was a guitar player kind of close enough. So the only way for me, you know, at the time to really get in on some of the work was just to put together a little guitar rig and play guitar. So I was like, well, I'll do that. I just want to get the work. You know, I just want to get in the room.
Well, that makes it easier to get in the door when you got more tools in your belt, you know?
Yeah, right. So, yeah, when I moved here, I kind of wasn't sure if I was going to end up being a bass player or a guitar player, but I just got called more for guitar stuff, and that might say something about my bass playing, but I don't know.
Well, we're glad to have you, and we really appreciate you. And just some cool stuff, you know, we recorded, and we'll play it later tonight. And Danny and I have, which a lot of people in country music do, have a big affinity for Merle Haggard. But, you know, we just kind of always end up talking about it and wanted to cut some Merle Haggard songs. And we ended up doing Footlights, at just kind of a one-off in his studio at his house. And he volunteered to do it all and ended up recording almost all the instruments. And then it was just a heck of a lot of fun, and I think it turned out pretty good. So it's going to be on a record, too. Well, do you want to play one for us?
Yeah, we should get our band back.
Yeah, do you think that band will come back in here? Honky-tonk Aristocracy? They took an early beer break, I guess. I don't know what they're thinking. Anyway, we'll do this real quick. Anybody out there got a question they want to ask for Danny? Any aspiring Panama Cityans that might want to make the move to Nashville to get into country music, or anybody else out there that's familiar with Danny's work? He's been a road dog for a lot of people, and is just always busy. I always appreciate that about that. He's hustling, and on top of that, another thing is he's got 3 kids and a wife at home, and he's able to manage all that and being on the road and being dad, and you never miss out on anything.
That's 99% because of my wife.
Yeah, well, you put a lot of effort in. I know you do.
We'll give an extra half.
Yeah, and you've been married a long time, so that says a lot about you too. So, anyway, we appreciate you. All right, no questions out there. We're gonna roll with it and let Danny play a song, and it's not called Danny's song.
Right. No, this is. This is honestly one of my favorite Merle Haggard songs ever. And I don't know, for whatever reason, this has just been one that I've actually sang this to my kids at bedtime thousands of times at this point, probably.
What a good song.
Silver wings shining in the sunlight, roaring engine, headed somewhere in flight. They're taking you away, leaving me lonely. Silver fading out of sight. Don't leave me
Don't take that airplane ride, but you like me out of your mind. Let me stand in here behind. Silver wings shining in the sun. Somewhere in flight, they're taking you away, leaving me lonely. Silver wing, slowly fading out of sight. Don't leave me, I cry. Don't take that airplane ride. But you lock me out of your mind. Let me stand in here behind. Silver wings shining in the sun. Taking you away, leaving me lonely. Silver wings, slowly fading out of sight. Slowly fading out of sight. Slowly fading out of sight.
Yeah, I like that. And I like your singing too, by the way. Your picking ain't too bad.
Yeah.
Man, what a talent. Thank you, Danny. We really appreciate that. That was good stuff. I hope your wife enjoyed that. All right, what we got next? Oh, no. You know what the best thing to do after you play a Merle Haggard song is?
Play
another Merle Haggard song. Go ahead. Why not? Can't go wrong with that, can you? Most men only dream of. I make my living writing songs and singing them. And I'm 41 years old, and I ain't got no place to go when it's over. So I'll hide my age and take the stage and try to kick the footlights out again. And I throw my old guitar across the stage, and then the bass man takes the ball. And the crowd goes nearly wild. See my guitar nearly fall. And after 20 years of pick, well, I'm still alive and kicking down the wall. Yeah, tonight I'll kick footlights out and walk away without a curtain call. Yeah, tonight
mighty grin. Yeah, tonight I kick the footlights out again.
One of my that probably might be my favorite Merle Haggard song. It's up there. Of course, he's got like 75 favorites.
All right.
What's this next thing? Huh? I don't either. I don't even know how to play it. Can somebody help me out? Now, is it gonna be what's it called? We're gonna let the Honky Tonk Aristocracy just rip a little bit. Y'all go ahead.
Thank you.
How about some of that? How many times have y'all played that?
One now.
There you go. All right. See, that's why I hurt these people. They make me look good. Good job, boys and girls. All right, what we got? There you go. We're gonna go out with a little Don Williams song, and it seems to be a fitting song these days, I think. Good. I hope you come back and see us again real soon. Thank y'all for joining us on my show, Honky Tonkitis, inside Nashville. I'm Big City Brian Wright. This is my band, the Honky Tonk Aristocracy. Y'all take it out. We'll be right back.
swing man.
Look at day over 29.